Young Muslims, let's have a seat, please. Inshallah, we're going to begin our program. Bismillah wa hamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala ma'bad. Alhamdulillah, we're going to begin our program with our guest speaker for tonight, Sheikh Youssef Soussi. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserve him and protect him and his family. Inshallah, the topic is a topic that's well needed here in our society. And the topic for the night is it really just Sunnah? Is it really just Sunnah? So we're not going to prolong with long introductions, but we do want to just mention that Sheikh Youssef, has memorized the Quran, alhamdulillah, and he's a very excellent source for the spread of the da'wah. He's a very excellent source for the spread of the da'wah, and in particular between Muslims and non-Muslims, in helping people to understand Islam in the correct way, to open up their minds, we'll say. So hopefully tonight we can be enlightened by our Sheikh, and may Allah guide us all and protect us and let us all benefit from what we hear.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen wa usalli wa usallimu ala man bu'itha rahmatan lil alameen. First, I would like to just say that I'm very humbled to be here for Jazakum Allah Khair, and may Allah reward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward our brother Imam and Sheikh Yasin Barakallahu Fih for reaching out to me in Minnesota. And he told me that he was, prior to him leaving, he said that he was going to invite me, and it seemed like he kept his promise, which is, of course, that's what men do, is they keep their promise. But may Allah reward him. I just want to make a quick correction. The word Sheikh it's a very weighty word. It's a word that is very heavy, but it is often abused in American society, and it's loosely used in America. So I personally don't like the word Sheikh. Of course, it's a person of knowledge, a person who has knowledge, but the word Sheikh to me carries more than that. It carries knowledge, great amounts of knowledge, great experience, age, wisdom, and so forth. So the word Sheikh, it can be referred, of course, to an elderly man, an elderly person, but it can also be referred to someone of knowledge. So I just wanted to make that clarification. It seems everybody and anybody in America today is called a Sheikh. Anybody who gives a lecture is called a Sheikh. And I'm sure our brother, Imam Yasin Barakallahu Fih, is very aware of that, but out of his hospitality, he said that, may Allah reward him. So the name of our muhadara is it really just Sunnah? SubhanAllah, how many of us here have heard that from maybe even our own relatives or family? Is it just Sunnah or is it Fard? I've heard that in my own immediate family, in my own immediate circles. Okay, anybody else? Okay, two people. Yeah, so you hear this sometimes from Muslims where they'll ask you, is that wajib? Is it Fard? Is it mandatory or is it just Sunnah? What they're trying to say here, is it really, really important or is it just somewhat important? That's what they're trying to say. Is it something that I really, really need to do? Or is it something that is just, oh, if I do, good. If I don't do, then that's also good, right? This is what we see happening across the stage. And I want to adjust that meaning, and I want to revive the meaning that the Sahaba radiallahu anhum in the first centuries had, that they didn't used to necessarily separate between, is this Sunnah Mu'akkada, is this Sunnah Ratiba? Whatever they saw the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام do, they did, they've embodied, and they copied the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. They've embodied that role model. And the reason being is because they themselves knew that there was nothing good, only that the Prophet guided them to, and there was nothing evil that the Prophet himself was aware of, only that he told them to stay away from. And they really, really embodied this principle, right? كما قال الله وما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه. وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُ. Whatever the Prophet commanded you to do, then do it. And whatever he refrained you or kept you from doing, then too, for us to stay away from. Having said that, today, many repeat this. It's just the Sunnah. Is it Sunnah Ratiba? Is it Wajib? Is it Fard? Is it Mustahab? Is it Makruh? You know, these Taqsimat. And these Taqsimat, these classifications, they're legitimate without a shadow of a doubt. But however, we focus so much, it's as if one wants to say, okay, it's just a sunnah, so oh, I'm not going to apply it anymore. And what I want to do here this evening is I want to share with you a few examples of how the early centuries viewed the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam quite differently than the way we view it. Okay, so I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to untie the knot from my tongue, Allahumma ameen, and for you to be receptive of such speech. The first thing that I want to start off with is a fascinating passage by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. He said there are three things that if one is not included, then the rest will not be accepted. One of them, he says, وَأَطِيعُ اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولَ فَمَنْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهَ وَلَمْ يُطِعَ الرَّسُولَ لَا يُقْبَلُ مِنْهُ. Obey Allah and His Messenger. So whomsoever obeys Allah but does not obey the Messenger, Allah will not accept from him. So this idea of separating, is it in the Quran? That's another thing as well. How many of us heard people say that before? Is it in the Quran? Is it explicitly in the Quran? And if you say no, it's as if they say, oh, okay, then I'm not going to abide by it. We will find a lot of furud and wajibat, directives and commandments that we follow on a day in and day out basis, they're not actually found in the Quran. They're not. A lot of what we practice in our deen, it is not found in the Quran. It's not. And that's why there's a firqa called Al-Qur'aniyun. Al-Qur'aniyun, what they do is they apply what is in the Quran. If it is not in the Quran, they don't give it much importance. And this, of course, it's very, very dangerous because the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he narrates to us in the hadith that's narrated in Abu Dawood, min hadith al-Maqdam ibn Ma'di Karib, where the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, and this is a warning to he who comes after, he says, لا ألفين أحدكم على أريكته يأتيه الأمر من أمري مما أمرت به أو نهيت عنه فيقول ما وجدنا في هذا الكتاب اتبعناه. He says, let me not find someone to come after me sitting on a nice piece of furniture, and he gets the commandment from me. He receives the commandment on my behalf. And then he says, oh no, whatever we find in the book of Allah, that's exactly what we follow. Meaning that if it's not in the book of Allah, I'm not going to follow it. This is exactly what this person is saying. But if we compare the Quran and we compare the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, we'll find that the Sunnah does not need the Quran like the Quran needs the Sunnah. The Quran, of course, it's priority. The Sunnah is also a priority. But the Quran needs the Sunnah more than the Sunnah needs the Quran. And this is exactly what Imam Al-Awza'i said. He says, حَاجَةُ الْقُرْآنِ إِلَى السُنَّةِ أَحْوَجُ مِنْ حَاجَةِ السُنَّةِ إِلَى الْقُرْآنِ. And the reason why he explains this, he says that the Quran needs the Sunnah more than the necessity of the Sunnah to the Quran. The reason why he says this is that there was a man who came to Amran ibn Husayn, and this is narrated in Musnad ibn al-Mubarak. This man comes to Amran ibn Husayn, and he said, Hadithni, talk to me about the book of Allah. He asked him a question. When he answered him, he didn't like the answer. He says, talk to me about everything other than the book of Allah. Amran ibn Husayn got a bit frustrated, and he said, Innaka mru'un ahmaq. You're very naive, you're a simpleton. He says, أَتَجِدُ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ أَنَّ صَلَاةِ الظُّهْرِ أَرْبَعُ رَكَعَاتٍ لَا يُجْهَرُ فِيهَا. He said, you're naive. Do you find in the book of Allah where Salat al-Dhuhr is four raka'at and you read it to yourself and it's not made aloud? Do you find that in the book of Allah? He said, do you find the numbers of Salat in the book of Allah? Do you find how to give zakat in the book of Allah? He said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala أنزل الله ذلك في كتابه والسنة تفسر ذلك. He says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals these terms in general terms in the Quran. However, it is the sunnah that explains and expounds and clarifies exactly how we pray, exactly how we offer the sunnah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, He says for us to establish prayer. But nowhere in the Quran does He say how much we are to pray. So if I gave a Muslim today who reverted today, if we as a Muslim community gave him a Quran and we said, take this book and read it. When you're done, I want you to offer salat. Do you guys think here that that person is going to pray the way we do?
No.
Just by using the Quran? No. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, Sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli. Pray the same way you have seen me pray. That's why the Quran and the prophetic tradition of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, they complement one another. One cannot go without the other. Again, they're not in contradicting mode with one another. However, they complement each other. They complement one each other. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, and it's narrated that he used to write everything that he heard from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So Quraysh one day told him, why are you writing everything that you hear from the Prophet, from your Prophet? And he's a human being. He speaks when he's mad, and he also speaks when he's angry. So Abdullah ibn Amr, he stopped for a while until he related that to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. The Prophet told him, "Uktub fawalladhi nafsi biyadihi fa'uma'a bi'isbi'ihi ila fih wa qal, uktub fawalladhi nafsi biyadihi la yakhruju minhu illa haq." He says, write by he whom my soul is in his hand. And the Prophet took his index finger and pointed it to his mouth and he said, write what you hear from me, for there is only nothing but truth that comes out of my mouth. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, in the Quran, the Dhuhr is not arba rakaat, right? In the Quran, we don't find that. Is the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, is he making ijtihad when he says that Dhuhr is 4 rakaat? Is he making it up on his own?
No,
he's not. It's the Sunnah, it's not the Quran. The Quran is the literal revelation of Allah. The Sunnah is revelation from Allah, but not in the literal sense. Meaning it's not verbatim, but it's still wahi. Allah says, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. It is not revelation, it is not from his own desires, right? It is not from the Prophet where he tells us to pray 4 rakaat for Dhuhr, 4 rakaat for Asr, 3 rakaat for Maghrib, and so forth, right? All of these are directives and commands from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the tongue of who? On the tongue of his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Having said that as an introduction, we find in the early stages, in the early communities, for them to apply the Sunnah, it was a part of them. It was truly, truly remarkable the way they used to apply the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. You will find, as I share many instances with you, that they did not take the time to ask the Prophet, is this wajib? O Prophet of Allah, do I have to do it? They hurtled. They used to race with each other to try to follow the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam in each and every step of his life. Why? Because they really embodied. See, there's a difference in between saying something. I love, like, how many of us in here love the Prophet? It's easy. Allah, is that a question? Right? It's rhetorical. But when it comes down to truly applying the Sunnah of the Prophet, this is where question marks are going to fly everywhere. Now, I'm not questioning you here. But a lot of us, yeah, I love the Prophet. Yeah, I love the Sunnah. But in terms of application, this is where we're going to see a lot of question marks. Why are you leaving this? Why are you taking this? Why do you prefer this over this? And so on and so forth, right? So it becomes a bit murky. It's somewhat of the gray area, okay? It's narrated by Imam Ahmad that Mujahid, radiallahu anhu, the great tabi'i, he was walking with Abdullah ibn Umar. And I want to actually, if I want to stand up and do this so you guys can get a better idea of what it is I'm hinting at. They were traveling one time. And as they were traveling, Mujahid was with Abdullah ibn Umar. So when they traveled, Abdullah ibn Umar was walking. He got out of the way, and then he came back and he continued his travel. Mujahid asked him, why did you do what you did? There was nothing in front of you. Now, he didn't move because there was a puddle. He didn't move because there was a huge rock. He moved. Why? He answered him. He said, the reason why I moved, Ya Mujahid, is because one time I was with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam during travel. I saw him move out of the way. So I moved from the way, the same way the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam moved. Do you guys see shiddat al-iqtida? How they were very, very keen to applying the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. There was nothing in his way. There was not a hole, there was not a pothole, there was not any, you know, nothing there. He moved out of the way simply because once upon a time he traveled with the Prophet and the Prophet moved out of that path. And so Abdullah ibn Umar wanted to do the same exact thing. Why? Just to follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam. It is narrated in Hadith Abu Dawood, in Hadith Abi Sa'id al-Khudri. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was leading his companions in prayer one day, and all of a sudden he takes his shoes off, which is also an indication that it is the sunnah to pray in your shoes so long as they're clean. But we are not to come into the masjid and say, brother, I want to pray with my shoes because it's sunnah. No, we have to use some logic here, because there's some brothers that go full force. It's the sunnah to pray in my shoes, bro. Yeah, keep your shoes out there, brother, okay? If you want to pray outside in your shoes, do that. But don't come in on top of the carpet, right, that we have to keep clean and pay people to clean it, and you want to pray in your shoes. So the Prophet, yarhamukallah. So the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, he took his shoes off and he threw them alongside of him. The Prophet, as soon as he did that, the companions took off their shoes and they threw it alongside themselves, on the side. Subhanallah, after the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he was done. He asked them, ما حملكم على إلقاء نعالكم? What made you all throw your shoes to the side? Do you know what they said? If I can hang this up on top of each and every Muslim home or each and every masjid, I would. They said, Ya Rasulallah, رَأَيْنَاكَ فَعَلْتَ رَأَيْنَاكَ فَعَلْتَ فَفَعَلْنَا. Very simple. O Prophet of Allah, we saw you do, so we did. Do you guys see how easy it was? They didn't finish and say, O Prophet of Allah, we were debating as to, should we take off our shoes or not? After the prayer, immediately, as soon as they saw the Prophet take off his shoes, they immediately took off their shoes. He says, لا ذلك جبريل أمرني أن في حذائي نجاسة أو كما قال. He said, that was Jibreel. He commanded me to take my shoes off because they had some impurities on them. But I want to illustrate here closely and vividly how the companions, the Prophet didn't, sometimes he didn't have to tell them to do certain things. Just upon them seeing the Prophet do something, they immediately did it. Why? Because they knew kullul khair is in following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet one time in the beginning, he had a gold ring. He wore it, and one time he took it and he threw it alongside, on the side of him. So the other companions, they took their rings immediately without the Prophet commanding them. Wal hadith fil Bukhari. The Prophet did not command them to throw their rings away. He didn't. They all took their rings and they threw it on the side. Now they didn't, first, two things here. They didn't ask the Prophet, oh ya Rasulullah, why are you throwing it? Is it amr? Is it a commandment from Allah? Why are you doing it? Neither one of them said, ya Rasulullah, this is a very fancy ring that my wife bought me for our anniversary. Do I have to throw it away? Right? You married? It's funny how it's the youngster that laughs, but the married folks don't laugh, right? All right. Inshallah, it's okay. It's not an insult. You get married, inshallah. Looks like you got a bit offended. Like, no, I don't get married. May Allah give you a pious wife, inshallah. So the companions, radiallahu anhum, they didn't say, Ya Rasulullah, why are you throwing away your ring? And they didn't say, Ya Rasulullah, this is a gift I got from my wife. This is a gift I got on my anniversary. Or, wallahi, we just got done celebrating our birthday last weekend. It was awesome. It was great. Do I have to throw it away, Ya Rasulullah? La, they didn't say none of that. I don't mean to be sarcastic. But this is kind of the difference between what they experienced and what they went through and kind of our experiences today. I feel today that we look for justifications after justification or excuse after excuse just so that we can apply other than what the Sunnah dictates and commands to justify. No, it's okay. No, it's not a problem. For them, it was different. Just upon seeing the Prophet ﷺ do, they did. And this is beautiful. This is beautiful. Naam. We also find that the companion radiallahu anhum, they got very, very angry when they saw someone compromising the Sunnah. When they saw someone compromising the Sunnah, they took it to heart. They took it personal. And guess what, guys? Rightfully so. It's okay for you to get angry when you see someone compromising the Sunnah. I'm not saying punching him. I'm not saying verbally abuse him. I'm not saying physically abuse him. Getting angry for the sake of Allah and actually using physical abuse or verbal abuse is not one and the same thing. Being angry is one thing, and verbal abuse and physical abuse, that's something that's completely different. Because when you say get angry, people immediately think, oh, he's advocating violence for us. No, this is not this does not mean that, and that does not necessarily mean this. It is narrated in Hadith Muslim, in Hadith Sa'id ibn Jubayr, that Sa'id ibn Jubayr, he says, Abdullah ibn Mughaffal, he had a close relative of his. What this close relative would do, he would take pebbles and he will just throw them arbitrarily, randomly, without any proper cause, without any intention. So when he saw him, Naha, he says, look, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam naha anil khadf, and he says, innaha la tasidu sayda wa la tanka'u aduwa walakinnaha taksiru sinna wa tafqa'u al-ayn. He says the Prophet commanded us not to do this. He said it doesn't hunt an animal. It only breaks the tooth and it gouges the eye. It doesn't do nothing beneficial. When he told him one time, he came back a second time and he found him doing the same thing that he did last time. Do you know what he told him? He didn't tell him, didn't I tell you last time not to do it, brother in Islam? He didn't tell him, dear brother, I love you for the sake of Allah. Why are you doing this again? No, he didn't say none of that. He says, لا أكلمك أبدا. He says, brother, not brother actually, he says, I am not going to talk to you again. Does he have the right to do that? Yes, he does. Why? Someone is compromising the dearest thing to him. If someone here uses vulgarity towards your parents, disrespects your parents, disrespects your wife in public or in private, how many of us will take it personal? Okay. Oh, yeah, it's, there you go. Why is it? Because of our love in our care that we have for our parents. So what bothers me is sometimes when people disrespect our parents, we will let the whole world know that we're angry, we're frustrated, and rightfully so. But why is it when it comes for the sake of Allah, we just seem to always turn the other cheek and we just say, oh brother, we're all sinners. Did we get that or was that confusing? Is it? What's more dear to us, the Sunnah of the Prophet or our relatives? So this Sahabi truly embodying that the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ is more important to him and more dear to him than anything else. When he saw someone compromising the Sunnah, he took it to heart. He took it personal. The same way if someone disrespects your child, your mom, your wife, your husband, etc., we take it personal. If someone is cursing your mom out, you're not just going to say, okay, let me know when you're done. I'm in the vehicle. Mom, just I'll be waiting for you. No, you're going to get riled. You probably maybe even lose your focus and lose your train of thought. Why? Because your mom is dear to you. So the least we can do when we see someone compromising the sunnah is it should bother us in the heart. كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, he says, من رأى منكم منكرا فليغيره بيده فلم يستطع فبلسانه فمن يستطع فبقلبه وذلك أضعف الإيمان. The Prophet, he says, this is a whole different discussion, but I just want to share this with you quickly. Whosoever sees a mischief, let him change it with his hand. If you can't change it with your hand, you don't have the authority to do so, then change it with your tongue. If you can't do that, then you have to dislike it in your heart. This is something, هَذَا مُطَالَبٌ مِنَ الْجَمِيعِ. This is something that all of us have to do, is we have to reject it with our hearts. Is he okay? It looks like he needs some water. So I just wanted to illustrate here, brothers and sisters, how they themselves, they used to get angry. They got frustrated with someone compromised the sunnah. Naam, and rightfully so. Rightfully so. Furthermore, Al-Bukhari, he narrates that Al-Humaydi was visited Al-Imam Al-Shafi'i once. In this sitting, a person asked Al-Imam Al-Shafi'i a question. Asked his companion a question. So he answered. And then Al-Imam Al-Shafi'i, he's asked the same question. Says, قَالَ فِيهَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ كَذَا وَكَذَا. When he asked him, he says, oh Shafi'i, what is your opinion? So someone already in the sitting already said and answered, the Prophet ﷺ said so, X, Y, Z. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, when this person asked him, oh Imam al-Shafi'i, what's your opinion? He got angry. He says, قَالَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. And you're asking me, what's my opinion? Someone just told you that the Messenger of Allah said, and you're asking me, what's my opinion? He says, أَتَرَانِ فِي كَنِيسَ أَتَرَانِ فِي بِيَعَ أَتَرَى أَنَّ عَلَى وَسْطِ زِنَّارَ. He says, do you see me in a church? Do you see me in a synagogue? Do you see me having one of the belts that they wear? They said, قَالَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, and you're telling me that what is my opinion? Meaning here, for us, this is something for us to learn. Anytime someone says, the Prophet said, make sure you don't come and say, well, this is my opinion. Don't. That's very, very scary. Because what you're saying is you're indirectly saying the Prophet doesn't know better. You can't truly hold the Prophet ﷺ as your paragon, as your leader ﷺ, and then come and say, well, I don't agree with him. If you have an opinion, a scholarly opinion that you say, well, this madhab said so and so, I feel more comfortable taking, that's a different story. But let not someone tell you the Prophet said and you interject and respond and say, well, in my opinion, I think, you know, my humble opinion. No opinion is humble if it's placed over the Prophet's opinion. I'm sorry. You can tell me your opinion is humble all day, but if you're trying to place your words over the Prophet, ﷺ, there's nothing humble about that opinion. That's an arrogant opinion, and that's not a legitimate opinion. So when the Prophet, ﷺ, when he says a verdict or he says, what do we say? قَالُوا سَمَعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. We heard and we obeyed. Now we heard and we argue. Why? Convince me hijab is wajib. Why? I mean, why do I have to convince you as a Muslimah that hijab is wajib? You're a Muslimah, right? Yes? Why do I have to, what do you mean when you say convince me? What does that really entail? What does it mean? Like when you're a Muslim and I say it's mandatory, you have to come to Jumu'ah, you have to pray five times a day. Convince, when you say convince me, what do you mean when you say convince me? It's like working a job and you say, well, convince me that I have to put in 40 hours a week. When we go to our jobs, we don't say convince me why I have to put in 40 hours. We just put in 40 hours and that's, we don't say nothing else, right? We don't add a word. We conform to it and we accept it and we have no problem with it whatsoever. Sah? So the companions, radiallahu anhu, they took it very personal when someone compromised the sunnah of the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, and rightfully so. Rightfully so. The companions, radiallahu anhum, this reminds me of a story of Abdullah ibn Umar, radiallahu anhu, where he got frustrated because he did not know one hadith that was circulating in Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu was sharing this hadith. This hadith in particular, Abdullah ibn Umar never heard before. Now, Abdullah ibn Umar, as all of you know, is the son of Umar ibn al-Khattab. And both of them, they were very, very, yani, they would make sure that they heard all of the ahadith they could from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, not just to hear, but to implement these ahadith. So one time, he sent Khabbab sahib al-Maqsura. And he sent him to Aisha radiallahu anha. Because Umar, Abdullah ibn Umar, he heard a hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, من صلى على جماعة وخرج معها ثم تبعها حتى تدفن كان له من الأجر قراطان. Whomsoever prays on a janazah and follows it until it is buried, he will have two qirat. Each qirat, this word is like a mountain of Uhud of good deeds. So Abdullah ibn Umar, he was perturbed, yani, okay. So he went and sent Khabbab sahib al-Maqsura to Aisha to make sure that Abu Hurairah was not mistaken. Not to make sure that he wasn't lying, no, but to make sure Abu Hurairah was not mistaken this hadith with another prophetic tradition of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So when he went and he came back, Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, in the meantime, he was at the masjid and he had pebbles in his hands and he would throw it back and forth on the ground. So Abdullah ibn Umar, he asks him, أَصَحِيحٌ مَا قَالَهُ Abu Hurairah, is it true what Abu Hurairah said? He said, yes. Aisha said that the Prophet did say so-and-so. And he also says the other hadith that whomsoever prays on the janazah, but does not follow it until it's buried, he'll have one ajr of qirat. He'll have one mountain of hasanat. So if you pray on the janazah, you follow it until it's buried, you'll have two mountains. If you only pray on it and you don't follow it until it is buried, you'll have what? One qirat. You'll have one mountain. What did he do next? He took the pebbles and he threw them on the ground. Now, why do you guys think he threw it on the ground? I want you guys to participate, since it's not Salat al-Jumu'ah. What do you guys think his reaction was?
Doing the right thing to do.
Huh?
Doing on the ground because he knew it wasn't the right thing to do.
Okay, anybody else have an opinion?
He figured out that he was mistaken.
He was angry.
Huh?
He was angry.
He was angry. That's what I was trying to get to. He was angry. He was frustrated. Have you ever got maybe to an interview late and you lost the job, you didn't get the job because you were late? Did that ever happen to us? Don't you feel frustrated? Don't you get angry? If you had a business opportunity but you lost that business opportunity, or maybe something that was prosperous in front of your eyes or ahead of you, and you got angry because you what? That was something that you missed out on. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they used to view the application of the Prophet, of the Sunnah, of the Prophet والسلام, as a business, as not merchandise, but as a commerce. And that's exactly why. He took the pebbles and he threw them on the ground and he says, "Ah, لَقَدْ فَرَّطْنَا فِي قَرَارِيطَ كَثِيرًا." Oh, we have wasted many qarariyat, meaning we have wasted many mountains of hasanat. This gives you the impression, it really gives you the idea that Abdullah ibn Umar was frustrated because he had so many righteous deeds pass him by because he was not aware of this hadith. You know when you think you could have made so much money with one company? You didn't know it was local, and then years later you found out it was local, or it was hiring or something. You're like, oh, no way. After all these years, I find out it's just a mile away, or they've been hiring, or they're looking for people, yada, yada, yada. You're like, oh, no way. Why? You feel somewhat frustrated, agitated, right? Disgruntled. Why? Because you feel that was an opportunity that was now, it was lost. So this is exactly how they used to view the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, also with Utban ibn Malik, they used to, each one used to come one day to learn from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam, and then the companion would go back to his home, and then Umar would come the next day. The next day Utban would go and then come back to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam to learn. In other words, they found it within their busy schedules to learn their religious affairs. They took it upon themselves. And this is a calamity, I think, in our contemporary society where we have a lot of our Muslim youth. They're learning these sciences. And I don't want to call them secular sciences because they're not secular sciences. They're sciences that we as Muslims need. We need Muslim doctors. We need Muslim engineers. We need Muslim lawyers, Muslim attorneys. We need godly dentists. We need godly doctors. We need people like this. But however, there's a great imbalance because we invest so much of our years and our time studying all these sciences when we don't devote one-tenth of that time or energy towards learning our religion. So it's not a balance. It's a great imbalance. It's a large margin. It's maybe 95% to 5%, and that's being modest, right? And it's sad. It really is. So, inshallah ta'ala, I won't take up too much of your time. I will last with these two analogies, inshallah ta'ala. I will end it with this. Ibn Abi Hatim, he narrates a hadith, min hadith Safiya. She says that we were with Aisha radiallahu anha, and we used to mention the virtues, the great qualities and the great virtues of the women of Quraysh and the women of Ansar. فَعَائِشَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهَا, what did she say? قَالَتْ إِنَّ نِسَاءَ قُرَيْشٍ لَفُضَلًا وَلَكِنِّي وَاللَّهِ مَا رَأَيْتُ مِثْلَ نِسَاءَ الْأَنصَارِ تَصْدِيقًا بِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ وَلَا إِيمَانًا بِالتَّنزِيلِ. عَائِشَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهَا, she says, the women of Quraysh, indeed they're virtuous women, no one can deny that. However, I have yet to see the women like the women of Ansar, how they were very, very powerful and they had great strength in believing in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they had great faith. When Allah revealed, she continues to say, when Allah revealed the ayah of hijab, وَلْيَضْرِبْنَ بِخُمُرِهِنَّ عَلَى جُيُوبِهِنَّ, she says, the first thing the men did, they immediately, upon receiving this revelation from the Prophet alayhi salam, the Prophet, when he said this ayah, the men immediately went to their wives and told them that they have to cover up and they have to wear the hijab. Immediately after that, you know what Aisha says? She says, مَا مِنْهُنَّ مْرَأَةٌ إِلَّا وَقَامَتْ إِلَى مُرُوطِهَا فَأَصْبَحْنَا يُصَلِّينَ مُعْتَجِرَاتٍ وَكَأَنَّ عَلَى رُؤُوسِهِنَّ الْغِرْبَانِ. Aisha رضي الله عنها, she says, these women رضي الله عنهن, as soon as they heard that, they went immediately and they had these garments that they were wearing and they cut it. They cut these garments and they covered themselves with these garments and they prayed Fajr the next morning, the next day. It's as if they had crows on top of their hair, on top of their heads. Crows, kinaya an al-lawn al-aswad, crows, because when you think of crow, you think of the color black, right? And that's exactly what they used to wear. But the analogy here that I want to extract a beautiful benefit here, and that is that they did not sit there first and argue with their husbands. What do you mean? You think I'm gonna let I got my hair done, and you want me to wear hijab over it? You okay? Who told you this? After getting this kind of haircut, after getting this hair done, you want me to go wear hijab? They didn't argue first with their husbands. Also, notice how the husbands took it upon themselves. It is their responsibility, regardless of what's out there of equality and we're all alike. And no, men and women are different from each other. And this is a rahmah from Allah. Men and women are different. This is not me. This is what the book of Allah says. Different does not mean one is better than the other just by default. We are not to understand that. Men and women are different. And that's a rahmah of Allah. We are to complement each other, not compete with each other. And this is what's happening in our day today. We go in there, we want to butt heads and compete. One day on you and one day on me. It's, we have to complement each other. Naam? So the hadith, the men immediately when they heard this, they went to their wives and they told them that, okay, you must cover. The second thing is the women, they listened immediately and the next morning, they prayed with their hair, with their heads covered. SubhanAllah. Very easy, very basic, no arguments, no disputation. Well, why? Well, convince me. Well, I'm not ready yet. They didn't have this baggage that we do. Do you guys see the difference? And I don't mean to cause friction here, but do you guys see the difference between us and them? Huh? I'm going to get you in trouble? I'm going back to Minnesota. So y'all can do whatever y'all want to do. We're not talking about polygamy here. We're fine, right? On a serious note though, wallahi yani, when I look at this, it brings joy, subhanAllah, when you see just how we used to, yani, we used to be a people who used to submit easily to the will of Allah and to the will of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. We were never people of disputation and people of argumentation and why is this and I don't believe it, I'm not convinced yet. We didn't hear these, yani, they used to submit, right? I want to end with this, inshallah, just the story of Julaybib. Julaybib was a Sahabi radiallahu anhu, a noble companion. But he was, yani, he didn't have any money, he was not wealthy, he was not very well known. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he goes to a family. The Prophet asks him, oh Julaybib, did you get married? He says, no. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he goes to a family and he asks for their hand, for their daughter's hand. The family, elated, excited, well, of course we'll give you our daughter. Until the Prophet ﷺ says, no, it's not for me, it's for Julaybib. And then the father now, he interjects, he says, oh, no, oh, it's not for you. Okay, well, I'm going to have to ask her mother. So the Prophet ﷺ, he waited for a while. And then the husband went and told the mother that a man wants to marry, the Prophet ﷺ came asking for our daughter's hand. The wife, she was excited, elated as well. Well, of course we'll give him our daughter. The husband said, well, he came asking for our daughter's hand, but not for him, for Julaybib. So she says, ini, meaning, no, we're not going to give him Julaybib. Who's Julaybib? So the daughter, she was listening to the conversation. She walks out of the room or whatever they had at that time. She says, who came and asked for my hand? They said that Rasulullah came asking for your hand, for Julaybib. She says, idfa'uni ilay falay yudayyani Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Let me go to Julaybib, for the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam will not let me down. And Julaybib was not known for his good looks. This is something, not my opinion, this is what the scholars say. Julaybib was not known because of his good looks, radiallahu anhu. But of course Allah does not look at our looks. He does not look at the exterior. No, because that's a giver. We find immediately that Julaybib radiallahu anhu, they marry one another. He marries this daughter. He goes to battle and he dies in the battle. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he looks, he asks the companion, atafqiduna ahada? Do you guys miss someone? He said, oh no, ya Rasulullah. The Prophet says, bala, no, we're missing Julaybib. So they go and they find Julaybib radiallahu anhu killed, and surrounding him were many of the adversaries in the battle. He grabs him, the Prophet, and he puts him in the janazah with his own two arms, and he says, hadha minni, ana minhu wa huwa minni, I am of him and he is of me. He says that three times for Julaybib. Thabit was a companion. He told Abdullah ibn Abi Talha, he asked him, do you know what the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, what dua and supplication he made for the wife of Julaybib? He says, no. He says, the Prophet said a dua for her. He said, Allahumma subba alayha al-mala subba wa la taj'al aishaha kadda. Oh Allah, pour wealth upon her and don't make her life difficult. Thabit says, wallahi ma kana fil madinati ayyimun anfaqa minha. Says, there was not a woman in Medina who spent more in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than who? Than the wife of Julaybib. Now one is to ask, do you not agree with me that this is of the barakah of obeying the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Yes, it is. Yeah. So inshallah ta'ala, I did not put you all to sleep. I know it's the end of the week. I know it's Friday night. Inshallah ta'ala, I just wanted to share that all with you. I really think, yani, for me, really, as a nasiha to all of us here, that the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, it is something that we as elderly folks, as parents, we need to learn ourselves. And when we learn the teachings of the Prophet ﷺ, we are to then teach these teachings to our children, and to our nephews, and to our nieces, and to teach them what the sunnah is. But again, we as elderly, as the elderly sector, as older people, we ourselves have to take it upon ourselves to learn it. And maybe I forgot one instance or one scenario. In the beginning of Islam, when the companions, radiallahu anhum, when they were praying, they used to face Bayt al-Maqdis, they used to face Jerusalem. So when the ayah was revealed, and the companions now are to face Mecca, they were in prayer. In being in prayer, another companion came in and he moved them towards Mecca. Neither one of them said why, neither one of them said what happened, neither one of them said, hey, what's going on? They just submitted to the will of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And of course, the will of the Prophet is in itself the will of who?
Allah.
Of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if I said anything that was correct, it's from Allah and Him alone. If I said anything that was incorrect, it's from minyum and shaitan. I'm not sure if there are any comments, questions, or...
JazakAllah khairan for the reminder. And as you said, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase us in iman, and with the faith that the companions radiallahu anhum ajmeen that they had with regard to the sunnah, with regard to following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us like them. Are there any comments, or rather questions, that is there anything that anyone did not understand or need further clarification on?
I have another question. Why did he take the gold ring off? That's when we knew not to wear gold anymore? Okay.
I got a question. Okay, it's so many hadiths out here. I know all of them compliment each other, but it seemed like one person can say this one hadith, and then another one say, well, this hadith says this. So then they go to this one is strong, or this one is weak, and this one is this. So there's so many different ways to implement the sunnah, or debate with sunnah, and this. So how do you...
Here's the thing. There are people who have specialties and expertise in this field, right? Some of us get overexcited when we read a book or two and we say, oh, I got it down packed. Oh, I got it down. It doesn't work like that. It's very different. And that's why the ulama have tried time and time again to make tawfiq bayna al-ahadith, where if there is one hadith, ظاهره التعارض, with another hadith, they will try to find ways of harmonizing the two texts or harmonizing the two prophetic traditions. And that's why it is only the scholars of hadith, the noble scholars, not students of knowledge, but scholars who are truly, truly great scholars, who can go in and delve into these texts and to find out, is this hadith muqaddam, muakhir, mansukh, is it not mansukh, is it muhkam, is it da'if, what's the sanad, and so forth. So that's why, like you said, you might see one hadith, it says A, another hadith, it says B. That doesn't necessarily mean that both of them contradict each other. If one looks deeply into the hadith, you'll find that maybe one hadith was revealed at the very beginning stage of Islam, and you'll find another hadith at the very later stage of Islam. But not knowing what was first and what was last, and not knowing what the ayats are of Allah that were revealed, and the ahkam al-tanzeel, and how things were revealed to the Prophet, one looks at it and says, wow, this is a contradiction. Right? Like Christians, they accuse a lot of Muslims of using abrogation as a way out of contradictions. Yeah. They'll say, oh, well, the Muslims, you know, they just resort, anytime they have a contradiction, they just resort to abrogation. This abrogates this and that. No, لا يجوز لأحد. It's not permissible for anybody just to come out of his head and say this abrogates this or that. It's by the dalil, it's by the expertise. And that's why I tell a lot of people, it's not easy to speak on behalf of Allah to say this is halal and this is haram and so forth. This is a science. A science. The same way you have doctors, you have engineers, you have lawyers, you have whatever you call it, that's a science. People go to school for 8 years, if not more, to become experts and specialists in the science. That's the same thing with the deen. The deen, don't think that the deen is just reading that book of Quran, then Bukhari wa Muslim, a few hadith here over there, and you become a scholar overnight. It doesn't work like that. It's memorizing. It's 52 sciences. It's 52 sciences, if you find out. Now, the ulum al-shari'a are 52 sciences. That's a lot of sciences to study. Now, it's Arabic, it's rhetoric, it's balagha, it's nahu, it's fiqh, it's a lot of sciences. So my suggestion to you, dear brother, is if you do see that there's somewhat of a contradiction, that on the plain sight, it looks like it's a contradiction, I ask you to always resort to the people of knowledge for them to look maybe closer or deeper into this hadith, and I am sure you will find that which will please you, inshallah ta'ala, at the end.
Okay.
Yes.
So, none of the other prophets, because they say it's hadith about Jesus said this and this and that. So, it's only the Sunnah and hadith of Muhammad, right? Somebody wants to talk about Prophet Muhammad. There's no hadith of Jesus, Moses, Abraham. There's no hadith.
Anything that is not found in the Quran, anything that's not found either A, in the Quran, or B, in the Sunnah, and it's narrated on behalf of, maybe it shares with us a story of Musa, or it shares a story of Isa. If it's not in the Quran or Sunnah, we have to say it's of al-Isra'iliyat. It's of those of the people of the scripture or the people of the books, maybe in their gospels, the New Testament, in the Apocrypha writings, maybe in their other gospels that were not compiled as part of the canon. Those, it's possible that it's part of that. The other thing to also consider, for instance, we don't have something that confirms that Jesus walked on water. But I, as a Muslim, do I believe in miracles?
No.
What kind of Muslims are you? No, we believe in miracles, right? Nah. Musa, what did he do? He parted the Red Sea. That's a miracle. Right? Ibrahim alayhi salam, he was cast, he was thrown in the fire, and he was saved. Which means that fire doesn't intrinsically burn, it burns by the will of Allah. So going back to that, I, as a Muslim, I don't find that. The proper way of looking at this is we don't have a prophetic tradition telling us that Jesus walked on water. The Quran doesn't tell us that Jesus walked on water. But do I, as a Muslim, have a problem? Does it have any theological bearings on my faith if I believe that Jesus walked on water? Would this have any problem with my faith?
No.
No. Because it remains a miracle. Is that kind of...
Yeah.
But if it has to do with Jesus, the deity of Jesus, such as Jesus say, I and the Father are one, it doesn't mean that he's God. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. That doesn't mean he's God. Right? But if Jesus says a few things that completely contradict our religion, and we find them in what are called the Isra'iliyat, I, as a Muslim, I have to say, no, Jesus never said something like this. So, does that help, inshallah?
Yeah.
Any...
Alhamdulillah. We'll end inshallah right now, and I know some people there are smelling the food, so we're gonna go ahead and get to that. Thank you all for coming out. Please try to benefit and implement some of what you have heard. Assalamu alaikum.
Son, it's the book.